Hi, my name is Shreya. I am one of the junior soldiers in the Clarenville Corps. I want to welcome you to our online service this morning. I've been asked to read our call to worship from Psalm 95, verses 1 to 7. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come to him with thanksgiving. Let us sing sounds of praise to him. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. He holds in his hands the depths of the earth and the mightiest mountains. The sea belongs to him, for he made it. His hands form the dry land too. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God. We are the people he watches over, the flock under his care. If only you would listen to his voice today.
Good morning, everyone. I just want to do a special thank you to our young people, and most importantly, Shreya. Shreya, hopefully I'm pronouncing your name correct. God bless you for taking the time to do this, and what a wonderful reader that you are. Well, our opening song this morning is in the Psalm book, Psalm 25. God's love to me is wonderful. Is he wonderful to you? I hope and pray that he is today. But we're going to be backed up this morning by a band from all the way out west. And I took privilege of, or advantage of my sister who plays in the Glenmore Temple Band. And they're doing this Zoom thing with the bands. And I asked them if they could send some of their numbers to us. And they did that. So a special thank you to Bandmaster Jeff, and of course the band and himself. So join along with us as they play this number for us, and the words will be there for you to sing along with us. God's love to me is wonderful. Sing along with that number this morning. Once again, thank you to the Glenmore Temple Band. And not to take away from our own band, but I decided to do something different. Well, we're entering a time now of worship, and we have, like we always do, two or three choruses to sing along. And the first one is, He's My Lord. Hallelujah. There is no other one, by the way, who can calm the storms of life like my Lord. He gives rest to the weary, Are you weary these days? We're weary on some certain days. And new life to the hopeless. Are you hopeless? Are you discouraged? Well, we want to tell you this morning about our Lord. There's no doubt about it, that He's my Lord. Sing along with us. He's my Lord. There is no other one.
He's my Lord.
Glory to God forevermore. Heaven is in my soul. We're going to sing that through a couple of times, and then we're going to go into, and that's enough to make me sing. Is it enough to make you sing this morning? Sing along with us. Heaven is in my soul today. And if he's not in your soul, if Jesus is not in your soul, I'm giving the invitation right now. Ask him within your heart. May God bless you. Let's sing it together. Heaven is in my soul today. Peter Chalk, and he's doing children's songs. God bless our youth workers for taking this endeavor on, and we pray God's blessing upon every one of them. So sit back and enjoy what Peter has to say to us, not just to young people, but to all of us this morning. God bless you.
Hello, boys and girls. How are you guys today? I'm feeling great, and it's so nice to be here with you guys. Not in person, but this is just as good and during these times, but we can't wait to get with you guys and meet up and have lots of fun and fellowship in the name of the Lord together. But until then, here we are. And today's children's time is about the armor of God. Now you guys might be wondering what the armor of God is, but there's a Bible verse that goes with this, and the Bible verse comes from Ephesians 6 and 10 to 18. And that says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Now, you're probably wondering how to be strong in the Lord during your everyday life. Well, that's what the armor of God is. When you're feeling trouble or worried or you don't know what to do, you pretend to put on the armor of God. And the armor of God is going to be what I'm going to show you. It's not actual real armor. It's not like a knight or, you know, and back in the castle days. But it is. It could be anything. Anything you put on could symbolize the armor of God. So first piece of armor that we have for you guys is the feet prepared with the gospel of peace. And you guys think maybe these special boots or something like that for this armor? No, it could be anything. And by anything, and Gracie's here to be our model today, and here is her boots for her feet prepared for the gospel of peace. You put them on, yep. The gospel of peace is being right with God and being contented in troubled times. Jesus said, peacemakers were blessed. Now she's ready. She's ready to go. She got her boots on. She's going to go tell everyone the gospel of peace, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay, well, our next piece of armor in our suit of armor is the breastplate of righteousness. Now, we don't have a real breastplate, but we got this. And this is a really strong piece of armor. This is nothing can beat this down and take it out. There you go. That's a great breastplate of righteousness.
This is great.
And this breastplate of righteousness represents righteousness is being honest, good, humble, and fair to others. It means standing up for weaker people. Well, if you're in, not so much in school these days, but if you're going outside and you see one of your friends being bullied or in trouble, someone would be picking on them, for instance, like that, that means with the help of this breastplate of righteousness, and God, you can help them and be a really good friend to them. Now, the next piece in our suit of armor, of God's armor, is the sword of the Spirit. Now we got a sword this time. Now, that doesn't mean you all go walking around with a sword in your hand, but the sword of the Spirit represents, this is what it means, which is the word of God. God's word is our offensive weapon. When we tell others about what the Bible says, the Holy Spirit helps people see their bad thoughts and actions and makes them want to be forgiven. Oh, careful, it's very sharp. Not really. Okay, and now our next piece in the suit of armor is the belt of truth. Now this is the belt we have. It's Gracie's belt, actually. There you go. I don't know if it'll fit.
It
fits. There you go. That's the belt of truth.
So that fit.
Now, the belt of truth keeps us from giving in to the world's beliefs. Compare your beliefs and action to the truth and the word of God. You know, people around you are doing bad things. It doesn't mean that you got to do bad things too, right? Because it's like you say, what would Jesus do? Would Jesus do the bad things? No, he wouldn't. So that's where this comes in, and you got to make the right decisions. Now, the next piece in God's armor is the shield of faith. Now, this is the shield of faith. Now this shield of faith means that faith is being sure that God will keep his promises. Faith in God protects you when you are tempted to doubt. And that's exactly what it means. When you're tempted to do something wrong, this faith and the shield of faith will protect you from doing that. Right? Okay. Okay, now here's our final piece in God's armor. You ready? Our final piece is the helmet of salvation. Now, there you go.
Can you put these things
down? Oh, that's where you're supposed to be. Like that. Okay. There you go. Now, that don't mean you gotta walk around all day with this thing on your head, right? But the helmet of salvation. Put on the helmet of salvation by believing that Jesus Christ died for your sins and rose again, which is the most important thing. He died and rose again to forgive our sins, that we can be forgiven, right? Now, here you go. This is God's suit of armor.
The heavyweight champion of God.
Yeah, there you go. I think it's great. Now, I don't think she's going to walk around like this all day, but this is just to represent. If you feel troubled, you feel worried, put on God's armor and you can face anything. Even little David beat the giant and he was wearing God's armor. Right? Alright, so we hope you guys had fun today. We certainly did, and we can't wait to see you guys soon, hopefully really soon. And so we're going to have a little prayer to finish it off. Ready? Our Heavenly Father, please be with us throughout the week. Please be with every little boy and girl to help them tackle any troubles they might have, to know that they can always put on God's armor and get them through it. In your Lord's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Well, as you've heard us say so many times in the past, in the last couple of months, one of the most important times of our meeting is our prayer time, and we're entering into that. We're going to sing the chorus a couple of times, an old chorus that I mentioned a few Sundays ago or a month ago about our friends out in Midland, Ontario. This is Lauren's favorite chorus, I believe. He is more than enough. He is more than enough. He is El Shaddai, the God of plenty, the all-sufficient one, my friends. God Almighty, he is more than enough. He is more than all this world would throw at us. He can get us through this. And there's nothing that we cannot ask of our Lord that he will hear us. And we're going to sing it through a couple of times. And then Violet Wayland is going to bring us to God's throne in prayer. Thank you, Violet, so much for doing that. And Violet is like a lot of us now. She's apprehensive about the camera. but she's going to do a wonderful job, and she's done it in the past. So let's sing along a couple of times, and then Violet will lead us into a time of prayer. He is more than enough. Sing along with us, a beautiful chorus.
Unconditionally. You created us in your image. How can we not praise you and worship you for who you are? You are a God of miracles, a God who is still in the healing business. Father, our hearts cry out to you today to tell you that we love you and we honor you for who you are. We thank you for the opportunity to be able to do this service where so many people can hear the gospel and to know the plan of salvation. Lord, we pray for our families and friends who are listening to this online ministry, who have not yet have a personal relationship with you. Father, through the power of your Holy Spirit, help them to realize they need you now more than ever. We bring the sick and those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. Father, we pray you will give them comfort and healing to their hearts and minds. And Father, we continue to pray for those who work in our hospitals and in our senior homes. We pray for our leaders in government, and those who have to make decisions for our province and our communities. Dear God, please give them wisdom and understanding. We pray for our RCMP officers. Protect them as they give their all for the safety of others. And Lord, I ask a special anointing upon our pastors. And as Major Bill presents the word to us this morning, I pray for power and strength that only comes from on high. And may those who listen apply it to our hearts and draw us closer to you. Bless and protect us through the remainder of this day and the days to come. I ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Savior. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Our scripture reading today is from Matthew 16, 13 to 18. Matthew 16, 13 to 18. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by the man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." And from Luke chapter 11, 29 to 32. Luke chapter 11, 29 to 32. As the crowds increased, Jesus said, "This is a wicked generation. It asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation. The Queen of the South will rise at the judgment with the men of this generation and condemn them, for she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom. And now one greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repeated at the preaching of Jonah, and now one greater than Jonah is here."
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Father, it's who you are. It's who you are.
can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me.
Time and again, oh, you must. just believe, and here's the reason why. With all the many miracles, why don't you think it's possible? With all the many things we've seen, why do you think it's just a dream? With all the things he's done for us, don't you think it's time we trust? Remember what is possible with all the many miracles. With all the many miracles, why don't you think it's possible? With all the many things we've seen, why would you think it's just a dream? With all the things he's done for us, don't you think it's time we trust? Remember what is possible with all the many miracles. Remember what is possible with all the many miracles.
Well, in our scripture reading this morning, the Lord knew of what some people were saying about him. But he wanted to know what Peter's thoughts were. And in Matthew 16 and 15 that Peter read, he said, Peter says this, "But Peter, whom do you say I am?" And Peter answers, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." If you were ever asked that question, what would be your answer? Did you ever consider what your answer would be if someone asked you that? I believe one of the answers was in the song that we sung earlier, we listened to, "You're a Good, Good Father." I was blessed this morning, I guess like many of you, by Lucas's selection of a song. And it was "With All the Many Miracles" was the title of the song that Lucas sang to us this morning. And basically what Lucas is saying to us, why doubt who Jesus is? We should know who Jesus is. There is no questioning, I believe, Lucas's faith in Jesus. If you were to ask Lucas, "Whom do you say Jesus is?" all I believe is you have to see the smile on his face, and he will give you the answer, that Jesus is the Son of the living God. Peter had the same encounter as I believe that Lucas had, that he was blessed by the Holy Spirit, and Lucas, I believe, answered the call of the Lord himself when he came upon his heart as such a young boy. Well, Peter had the same encounter as many of us have had over the years, that we can call on Christ and we can call him the Son of the living God. But I want you to pay attention to Jesus' response to what he said to Simon Peter. And he said, "Blessed are you, Simon Peter, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." Peter's life changed that day because he had an encounter with the Lord. He had an encounter with the Holy Spirit of God who spoke to his heart. And when you and I do the same, I'm going to tell you, our lives will change. And your life will never be the same. And I can contest to that. Billy Graham used to say many years ago to a statement before he preached, and I'm going to quote Mr. Graham today, "Today is a day of decisions." You get that? Today is a day of decisions. Today your life can change and it will never be the same. Are you ready for that change today? That day Peter's life changed. Jesus said to Peter in verse 18, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." Imagine Peter the fisherman, that the Lord will build his church on him. He says, "Peter, you are my rock, and I will build my church on what you do and what you say for my kingdom." Well, I want to tell you today, my friends, that the Spirit of God, when the Spirit of God falls afresh upon you, that you will never be the same, and that you can be a part of the kingdom making for our Lord. So the question I'm asking everyone out there today, whom do you say Jesus is? Really, whom do you say who Jesus is? I believe that this generation is asking that question, and you know what? They're also seeking answers. Who is Jesus? Is he who we claim to be? Some of them might ask. And you know what? You and I may be asked to give an answer to that question. So who is this Jesus you're talking about? Last week, a couple of weeks ago, I spoke about witnessing throughout the community. And with the summer now coming upon us, we're going to have once again opportunity to witness to our family and friends. And maybe your friend, your family, your brother, your sister, your mom, your dad, whoever it may be, they might ask you the question. Maybe you can have an answer for them. They might ask you, who is this Jesus I'm tired of you talking about? Tell me about him. Can he really change my life? I ask those questions. Can you prove to me that he is real? Have you been asked those questions? Can you prove to me that he is alive? Have you asked those questions, you or that are not proclaiming to be a Christian? Maybe you could ask them to listen to Lucas's singing this morning and read the words of the chorus, what it says, and I'm going to quote, with all the many miracles, why don't you think it's possible? With all the many things we've seen, why do you think it's just a dream? With all the things he's done for us, don't you think it's time for us to trust? Or maybe you can tell them this story. It's the story of a 7-year-old boy named Donnie. Now, I've used this illustration a few times over the years. And Donnie was in the classroom setting and was asked by his teacher. All the students in his class were asked by the teacher to write down the most important living person in the world. And all the little children started writing down their answers, and the teacher was going around and looking at what they were writing. One wrote down the Prime Minister of Canada, of course. One said their mom, another said their dad. Another said NHL star Connor McDavid. Another said Sidney Crosby. Now, I don't want the Toronto fans to get upset about me, so I added this. And Donnie said, and someone else said, and the other said, maybe it's Austin Matthews from the Toronto Maple Leafs. But then it was Donnie's turn. And he said, Miss, it's Jesus Christ. The teacher, who was a Christian herself, said, Donnie, I understand what you're saying, but I said the most important living person. But the teacher just smiled. And when she heard Donnie's response, and he said, but Miss, he is alive. He lives in my heart today. Does Jesus live in your heart? There is no doubt in Donnie's heart who Jesus was. Just like there's no doubting that Jesus lives in the heart of Lucas, who sang for us this morning. I said, all you have to see is the smile in his face to know that he's a follower of Jesus. But you know what? We have doubters. And maybe that's what I'm speaking to this morning. Many, we have the doubters in Scripture that we read, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, the scribes, the Bible scholars in Scripture. They doubted who Jesus was, and they seen Jesus, and they tried to disprove him over and over again. And yes, even the Israelites, even the Christian Jews wanted to know, they wanted proof, they wanted a miraculous miracle. The Israelites wanted Jesus to do something sensational to prove that he was really the Messiah. But Jesus tells him in Luke 11 and 29, he said, you're seeking for a sign. I'll give you a sign, he says. I am the sign. That's what Jesus says in Luke 11 and 29. And then in verse 31, Jesus says, even the queen of the south recognized the wisdom of Solomon. In other words, Jesus is saying, why can't you recognize me? Jesus said, in me, you have even greater wisdom than all the wisdom of Solomon. But I love my Lord and Savior because sometimes, and I'm not to compare myself to Jesus by no means, but I love Jesus because sometimes he says it like it is, doesn't he? He said to this congregation of people, now imagine me standing up here on a Sunday morning or Velma in Claremont Corps or any corps. And he said to them, you're blind. You cannot see the truth. You are deaf and you cannot hear the truth. Jesus said, I am the truth. I am the light of the world. Pretty bold statement, isn't it? Jesus wasn't always a soft-spoken man, was he? In verse 40, he calls the people foolish. Imagine if I got up here on a Sunday morning and I called all of you foolish. And then he goes on, woe to you, woe to you, woe to you, to the Pharisees. So the question I must ask you this morning, is there anyone out there doubting? Is there anyone blind like the Pharisees? Is there anywhere they're doubting who Jesus really is? If so, I want to challenge you to allow the Holy Spirit of God to speak to you today. And wherever you may be at this moment in your life, give God a chance. Give God a chance today. But I want to tell you about when the Holy Spirit of God speaks to you, what will be your reaction? Will you run away? Will you walk away? Only you know the answer. Because I believe within my own heart of hearts, and not to compare like Billy Graham at all means, but as Billy Graham would say, I believe that someone's life is going to be changed today. I believe that I'm speaking, that the Lord is speaking through me to speaking to some particular soul out there today that is doubting. But I hope you are not like the Pharisees, because their reaction was one of hostility. I hope and I pray that you will be like the people of Nineveh that I spoke about a few weeks ago. For they heard Jonah preach. You remember the story of Jonah when he ran away? But when he preached, they were humble and they repented of their sins because they allowed the Holy Spirit of God to speak to their hearts. They were willing to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. They were willing to hear the gospel like Peter was. And that's why Peter would say, Lord, you are indeed the Son of the living God. So can you say that today? Really, can you say that today? Yet sadly, there are so many out there trying to escape who Jesus is. But the truth is, my friends, we can't escape Jesus. Jonah tried, you've heard me say that before. He tried and he ran away from Nineveh. He ended up in Nineveh, though, proclaiming the gospel, as I just said. And because of a man of God like that, he preached, and the nation of Nineveh, the city of Nineveh, came to know the Lord. You heard me just a couple of weeks tell you that I ran away from the Lord. I ran out west, I ran to the north, I ran to the North Atlantic. But I couldn't run out Jesus, outrun Jesus. Nor can any of you. So once again, the question is, who is Jesus? Why can't we escape him? Is Jesus just a biblical hero? Or is he something more? Jesus only lived for 33 years. According to what I can find out, he never traveled more than 100 miles. He had no formal education. Hallelujah. He just listened to the scribes, and he listened when he got a chance, and he listened to his father. He listened to his stepfather, who was a carpenter. But he also listened to a spiritual father, God the Father. Some scholars say he was a man that came to lead a revolution. Well, did he? I believe he did. But only in the sense that he changed men and wives, men and women's lives, as well as children. But he never led a revolution against Rome or anything like that, like they wanted. Yes, the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, the Romans, tried their best to trap him and to prove him wrong, but they soon found out that they could not do that. They soon found out that he wasn't leading a revolution. No, Jesus was building a spiritual kingdom for his Father, just as he is doing today, by the way. He is building an eternal kingdom for you and for I. Yes, indeed, Jesus was a man, but he was more than just a man. He is El Shaddai, the God of plenty. He is the Son of God, if you're doubting that. In fact, in John 1, verses 1 to 2, it tells us, in the beginning was the Word, which was Jesus, and the Word was with God, and Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. What more proof do you want? Jesus, the living God, came to live among us. He came to save us. He came to bring his children home. He came to accept the sins of us on the cross. That's what the Bible teaches us. And when we come to him, we have to accept that. You have to claim that. And you have to live that, by the way. Jesus wasn't just here to read to lead a revolution, by no means. He wasn't just a hippie, as some would call a hippie. Some say he was because he had long hair and a beard. He wasn't just another great man, he was God incarnate, God in the flesh. No, we don't have no scientific proof who Jesus was, yet I still believe who he is, because Scripture tells me that. Why? Because of what he has done for me and for millions of others, and the joy and the peace and that security and love that he has placed within me and millions of others. Jesus was, my friends, who he claimed to be, God in the flesh. I believe, as I hope many of you believe, that the evidence is overwhelming that he is who he said he was, and he claims to be the Son of the living God. No, we can't prove it scientifically. I know that. But I can prove it by the lives that he is transforming every day. I can prove it because I believe he's going to change a life today. And I believe we're going to hear about that in the days that come. I can prove it because he transformed Bill Preston's life. I could not do that on my own. I got a job to do anything on my own. But Jesus changed my life, and as he did you. So do you know Jesus? I've been asking that question for the last few moments. Do you want to know him today? Do you want to know him today? Then I'm going to challenge you to go to him in prayer. Seek him in the quiet place, wherever that quiet place may be. For the Christian out there today, for you out there today that serve the Lord, if someone asks you, who is this Jesus that you were talking about? Do you have an answer? Well, if you don't have an answer, you better get it soon. Because I believe you're going to be asking these days, prove to me who Jesus is. Could you say that he's changed me? Could you say that to someone? Could you say, like a young girl just about 5 years of age, and I've used this illustration a few times as well because it's a great illustration, it's a great story because we lived it, we seen it, we heard it. It's about a little girl who belongs to colleagues of ours that were stationed close to us in Nova Scotia. And they took her to the doctor for her checkup. And the doctor was sitting down with her, asking her name and all this. And then she started asking all these questions. And all of a sudden she looked at the stethoscope. And she said, what is that? And the doctor's simple answer was, he said, all that is, he said, I can put it on your chest and on your back. And I can hear your heart beat. I can hear everything inside of you. I can hear if your heart's working good or if it's not working good. And immediately this young little 5-6-year-old girl said, then you can hear Jesus within my heart because he lives there. What a proud moment for a mom and dad. What a proud moment it must have been for our Lord when he heard that little girl say, because Jesus lives within my heart. Do you want to know my Jesus? Is he in your heart today? Do you know Jesus? Do you want to be changed today? What will your response to be today to the Holy Spirit that I believe is speaking to someone? When he speaks to you, I hope and pray that you're ready and that you won't turn him away. I hope and pray that you can say, Lord, thou art the living God because you live in my heart. If you can't, then why not ask him to take control of your life this morning and ask him to be your Savior today? And if you do, be assured of this. As Billy Graham would say, your life will never be the same. Step out in faith, my friend. Step out today and ask him within your heart. Well, we're going to sing a couple of choruses, and if we were in church, I guess we would call this the appeal time in the Salvation Army. And so we're going to sing a couple of choruses. And my wife, God bless her, is coming on to help us to do more than that, I guess, to play the music for us. But the chorus is a great chorus of encouragement, but it's also a great chorus of challenge. It says, if you want to know the power of God, get down at Jesus' feet. Do you want to know the power of God? I challenge you this morning. Then fall on bended knee and sing this chorus. It says, get down, brother. Get down, sister. Get down at Jesus' feet. But then it says, get down, sinner. That one that has been challenged this morning by the Holy Spirit of God that I believe is speaking to you. He's saying to you, get down, sinner. For the saint that may be getting a bit weary during these days, this chorus is saying to you, get down, saint. Get down at Jesus' feet and pray. Pray that this pandemic would soon be over. Pray that our churches would be once again filled to capacity where we can come and worship our Lord and Savior. That's the challenge I'm giving you to the saints of God this morning, whoever may be listening. We're going to sing it through a couple of times if you want to know the power of God. And if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you like I believe that He's doing, then get down at Jesus' feet and ask Him within your heart. Let's sing it together if you want to know the power of God.
If you want to
she don't want to sing along with me, you know. But we're going to try it again. If you only knew how many cuts this has taken this morning, it's also crazy. Oh, the wonder of it all. The wonder of it all. Now, my wife and I said this, clerical people have heard me say this before, that my wife had to put me on the straight and narrow because we used to argue about this chorus. And I said, now, I don't think that word should be there, think. It should be that to know. And she reminded me, no, Bill, think of it. Just to think that the creator of this world would love you, that would love me. You know, it took a long while, but now I get it. Just to think that God loves the likes of me. And He loves you, sinner. He loves you, saint. He loves you, brother. He loves you, sister. And get down at Jesus' feet. Let's sing it together, oh, the wonder of it all.
Oh, the wonder of it all.
Hallelujah. What a beautiful chorus. Well, it's been a privilege to worship with you this morning. Well, we're not done yet. We're going to sing another chorus. And it's a beautiful chorus. If there's someone out there today that have whispered that prayer, the Lord, come into my heart. Well, this chorus, this song is for you. Now, I'm going to ask my wife to have a good cough for herself to get it over with before we sing this, because it's four verses, but we're going to sing two straight through so we can give her a break. It's easy for me to say. I don't have the accordion on, isn't it? What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought. What? Since Jesus came into my heart. I have a light in my soul now that wasn't there one time, for which long I have sought. But Jesus, hallelujah, Jesus came into my heart. Let's sing it together, verses 1 and 2, and then the chorus through.
What a wonderful change in my life.
Since Jesus came into my heart, and no dark clouds of doubt, now my pathway obscure since Jesus came into my heart. And verse 4 says, I go there to dwell, hallelujah, on that heaven on high, in that city I know, since Jesus came into my heart. I'm happy, so happy as onward I go, since Jesus came into my heart. Now we're going to sing verses 3 and 4, and you're ready to go, are you, my dear? I give her a hard time, but I love her so. Hallelujah. Let's sing it together, verses 3 and 4. And if Velma's voice goes, then you know what? You got to deal with me. But God is in control. Let's sing it together. I'm possessed of all.
I'm possessed of all.
God watch over you and keep you. And now my wife, if she can, And I can't pray for her because she's a prayer warrior, but she's going to close our meeting off in prayer. Once again, may God bless you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you because we've had the privilege again to be able to share worship together.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, although it may be in a different way than we're used to, yet we know that you're not confined to time or place, but that wherever your people are, wherever there are people who are searching after you, you are there. And Lord, we thank you because we believe that you will use this ministry for your own glory, to accomplish your own purposes. And Lord, as your word is presented, we believe, Lord, that it will bring a harvest for the kingdom. Lord Jesus, we ask that you would be with each one of us,
yes,
that you will guide us by your Holy Spirit. And Lord, may we each day learn to put our hand in yours and to trust you, because we know, Lord, that you will never fail us. Lord, guide us and keep us each one. We pray in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you, everybody.